Now we move on to multi-level time series analysis. So what do we do if we have more than one person? So for a long time, during my PhD, I just focused on single subject data. And then maybe doing the analysis separately for different people. So it's like replicated time series analysis. But another way to approach data from multiple individuals is by extending the time series model to a multi-level model. So if we have data, time series data, so intensive longitudinal data of multiple subjects, then we might be interested in quantitative differences between those people rather than qualitative differences. So if I do a separate analysis for each person, I might end up with a completely different model for each person. If that's what I'm interested in, that's fine. If I think that maybe the underlying process is more or less the same, but they differ in the parameters of the process, then the multi-level approach is a really good idea. So that's what we will be talking about mostly, mostly. I think we are doing some N equals one stuff. What we can do is we can look at individual differences in lag relationships between the variable and itself. So that's differences in the autoregression. So regression between a variable and itself is referred to as autoregression. But also individual differences in lag relationships between different variables. And that's what we refer to as the cross-lagged relationships. It's crossed from one variable to another and lagged because it's at different time points. So it's maybe how my stress yesterday affects my happiness today. Now, you can build a multi-level model for this, and then you could refer to this as multi-level time series analysis. Or you could say, well, it's actually dynamic multi-level modeling. It's just depending on what perspective you take, right, or what point of departure. And I use the term dynamic multi-level modeling a lot because, the word dynamic is good, you know. So, and also that, you know, at least in psychology, people are more familiar with multi-level modeling than with time series analysis. So that seemed like a good way to enter it. And other people might come up with different names. So people have been doing this for a while. So how are they doing it before N plus existed? One way they have been doing it was by using standard multi-level regression software. And how do you do this? Well, you set your data up in long format. And this is also what we need when we are going to do it with N plus. So it's actually helpful to look at this. And here we have one variable ID. So that's the person variable. So we have multiple observations for person one, then for person two, and person capital N. Yeah. And then we have some variable called Y subscript I T. So I stands for person, and T stands for measurement occasion or time point. So we have Y11, 12, 13, and so on to 1 capital T for person 1. And then we start for person 2, first observation, second, third, up to capital T. And actually, you know, the capital T could be different for different people. And so on up to the last person. So this would be your data in long format. And then what you could do is just create the lagged predictor by using SPSS or R or whatever program you're using. So make a lagged version of this variable. So we have today's score with yesterday's score for person one, but also for person two, and so on. Of course, then you have to make sure that you make this one missing here, because otherwise you would be regressing person's two score at the first occasion on the last score of the first person. So you would have to do something, you know, when you switch from one person to another. So now you can use this as a predictor in your multi-level model. And you can also do this for another variable. So this could be my happiness today, happiness yesterday, but also stress yesterday. We can have these as predictors. So this would be for the autoregression, and this one would be for the cross-lagged regression. Now let's look at an example of the autoregressive relationship. So here we have negative effect of individual I at occasion t, which is regressed on negative effect of individual I at occasion t minus 1. As you can see, the regression coefficient here, which I refer to as phi, subscript I, is allowed to vary across individuals. That's why it has a subscript I. So the slope can be different. So that's where we have the quantitative differences in the process between people. The intercept is also allowed to differ, and then there is a residual term here, which is referred to as the innovation or the random shock residual, disturbance, perturbation, innovation. There's many terms for this. So it's basically everything that affects today's negative effect that's unrelated to yesterday's negative effect. So it could be how well I slept, or what I had for breakfast, how easy it was to get here this morning, whether Bengt was encouraging or not. You never know, yeah. It's like, it's random. So that's what's happening at level one. So for people familiar with multi-level modeling, this will be easy. For you who are not familiar with multi-level modeling, this might be a little challenging or new, but it's level one is the lower level, which here is the repeated measures. And then level two are the persons. So the data are nested. We have repeated measures nested in persons. So level two, we allow for individual differences in the intercept and individual differences in the autoregression. So the slope, the phi parameter. So this is the autoregression or the slope in the regression equation. Now this kind of research was, to my knowledge, first initiated by Sols, Green and Hillis in a paper in 98. And then basically no one ever did anything with it again until Peter Kuppens from Leuven started to work on this again. And they focus, the focus in this kind of research is on the autoregressive parameter phi, so which is sometimes referred to as inertia, because the closer it is to one, the more, you know, yesterday's score spills over or carries over into today. So if there was something that made you your negative effect peak yesterday, if you have a phi parameter close to one, then it will still be affecting your mood today and tomorrow and so on for quite a few days. If you are a person with a phi parameter close to zero, what happened yesterday doesn't matter. You know, like every day is a new day. So that's the idea of this term inertia. So it's about how quickly do you return to your baseline after being perturbed? Or how much carryover is there from one occasion to the next? You can also think of this as regulatory weakness. The idea is if we get stuck in a certain state, that's not a healthy kind of behavior. So that's why what the term regulatory weakness comes from. So if it's close to zero, that would be better than having one that's close to one. The work by Peter Kuppens and others has shown that it's positively, this autoregressive parameter, so the phi parameter, is positively related to current depression. So people who are depressed tend to have a higher autoregressive parameter. Also neuroticism, again positive, so people who are higher on neuroticism tend to have a higher autoregressive parameter. And also being female, so it's like the big three. And then they also have studies where it's been shown that it's predictive of later depression, even after controlling for current depression. So it's like later depression 2 or 2.5 years later. So it's an interesting finding because this seems to suggest that the way you regulate your moment-to-moment affect is actually something, if we know about the dynamics of this, this helps us to predict whether you are at risk of becoming depressed later on. So this immediately feels like going to causal conclusions, which of course we have to be careful with. But it's an interesting finding. If we focus on the cross-legs part, that's when we have multiple variables, and we look at the way that one variable predicts another one at another occasion. And one area in which this has been done is in what is referred to as dynamic networks. And they are basically based on a multi-level vector autoregressive one model. Or you could think of it as a multi-level extension of a cross-leg panel model. But you have multiple variables that predict themselves and each other over time. And that's what we see here. We have y1 to yk, so different variables, certain like symptoms that are associated with depression. And they are predicted from themselves. So here we see the autoregression for a variable 1, but also all the other variables at the previous occasion. And then we have y2, which is also predicted from y1, but also all the other lagged variables, up to k. We call it vector because it's multivariate, so that's what the V stands for. Autoregressive because you regress on the vector itself. Order 1 because it's only lag 1 that we are looking at. It's only current score compared to the previous score, but not the one before that. That would be lag 2. Now this idea of having this as a multi-level model was discussed in a paper by Laura Bringman in 2013 and is now further being popularized by the software of Sasha Epscom, for instance. The focus is really on the cross-leg parameters. So, and they talk about the variables as nodes because they have this link with network analysis. So then you talk about it as nodes and the strength between the connections of the nodes. And the idea is that psychopathology should not be, so that's in this area specifically, psychopathology should not be thought of as a latent variable causing all these symptoms, but instead we should think about psychopathology as symptoms that trigger each other. So for instance, if you think of depression, you don't sleep very well, therefore you cannot concentrate very well, therefore you make mistakes, therefore you get a lot of negative feedback from your boss, it stresses you out, you don't sleep well, and so on. So it's like these symptoms that trigger each other, rather than there is this one latent variable causing everything. So that's the case they're making. And part of what they do is using time series data or intensive longitudinal data, using those dynamic networks. So the idea then is that if you have stronger connections, so if those cross-legged parameters are larger, then if one symptom gets triggered, it spreads more easily to the other symptoms. Whereas if all the cross-legged parameters would be close to zero, then you might not sleep very well, but it's not going to make any changes in all the other symptoms. So psychopathology would be having stronger connections between the symptoms. All right. A fundamental problem. If we look at cross-sectional data, for instance, the relationship between the number of words that a person types and the percentage of typos, we might find this negative relationship. So we just have like 100 people and we let them type for 5 minutes. Then we see how many words did they type per minute and what's the percentage of typos they made. We might find this relationship. Now we would not try to generalize this to the individual level. We wouldn't say, okay, this means if I just type faster, I'm going to make fewer mistakes. Because we know at the within person level, there's probably a positive relationship. So within person, we have this relationship. If I type faster, I'm going to make more mistakes. If I type slower, I'm going to make fewer mistakes. And in this case, this relationship is exactly the same for all the individuals. No individual differences in this relationship. So how did we get this negative relationship in the cross-sectional data? Well, the people differ with respect to their means. So they're stable between person differences here. And here we see them as the blue dots. And so at the between person level, there's actually a strong negative relationship. And what is this reflecting? Well, maybe it's reflecting something like experience. So here we have a person with very little experience, a lot of experience, I should say. So the person can type a lot and make very few mistakes. And over here we have a person that types very slow and makes a lot of mistakes. So when we think of cross-sectional data, what is happening is we have a picture like this, and from each of these ellipses, we just take one point. That's cross-sectional data. We cannot tell to what extent this point represents the person's mean, and to what extent it represents a temporary deviation from the mean. So if we have cross-sectional data, we cannot separate the within-person relationship from the between-person relationship. We get something that's a blend of the two, and there's no way to tell. Of course, in this scenario, we might have a third variable, which is experience, and then we would be able to tell the difference. But in general, the point is that there might be many causes or factors related to this between-person relationship that we don't know. But if we have multi-level data or intensive longitudinal data, so we have repeated measures of the same people, of multiple people, then we can actually separate those two parts and find out what the within-person relationship is and the between-person relationship. So this is just showing the same thing in a different way. So cross-sectionally, we might have a correlation of minus 0.4, but this might be because within and between, it's also minus 0.4. But it could also be that within there is minus 0.8, whereas between there is zero. And what is adding to the confusion, probably, is that some people refer to cross-sectional as between person, because, of course, it's between persons. But we have to realize that part of it is stable between person, and that's the part that we would really refer to as between in a multi-level part. And part of it is temporary. And that's the within part, actually. You can also think of it like the trade part and the state part. So what we can also look at is those within-person slopes. So in the typing example that I gave, the within-person relationship was the same for each person. But it's also possible that we have different relationships. So here we have negative effect and how it's related to negative events. And so we might see that for this person, there is a little bit of a relationship. For this person, there is quite a strong relationship. And for this person, there's basically no relationship. So whether something negative happens or not does not really change this person's negative effect. Whereas here, there is a lot of change. And you can also do this for lagged relationships. So we can have current negative affect regressed on preceding negative affect. So this is the autoregressive relationship. So maybe one person here does not have a very strong relationship between yesterday's negative affect and today's negative affect. So it's like one of those persons that every day is a new day. Whereas here, there is a strong relationship. So there's a lot of carryover from one day to the next. So that's basically what these three bullets are saying also. One thing that especially people who are familiar with the multi-level literature will be thinking about is also about centering the predictor. So if we want to separate within and between in the right way, it's known from the multi-level literature that it's important to center the within-person predictor per person. So you have to subtract the mean of the individual from the predictor. And together with Raoul Grassmann, I published a paper in which we looked at how this works out when we are looking at a lagged predictor. So it's the same variable, so the autoregressive model. And we did a simulation study in which we compared not lagging Not centering the lagged predictor. So just leaving it as it is. So that would be, based on our knowledge from the multi-level literature, that would be wrong. It should lead to bias because it will mix the within and the between person relationship. And then we used the sample mean, but also a mean estimated from an empty model. So we just started with an empty model, estimate the person's mean based on this, and then use that for centering the lagged predictor and then run the multi-level AR model. And because we were doing a simulation, we also had the true mean. So then we thought, well, we can also use the true mean for sampling because, you know, we're in control here. So let's see what happens. And this is what happens. So here the phi parameter, so the autoregressive parameter, had a mean of 0.3. And there was some randomness to that as well. So it had a normal distribution. We varied the number of people from 20 to 100, and also the time points, number of time points per person from 20 to 100. And here we see the bias. And we see if you don't use any centering, which should be mixing the within and the between person relationship, and note the between person relationship is one because it's the same variable. Yeah? So the between person regression is one. But you see there's hardly any bias. Then if we used the sample mean, so that's what people would typically do and that's what people have been doing, you see that there is bias, negative bias. You see that the bias decreases as the number of time points increases, but you see that it does not really change as the number of subjects increase. So if you compare this one to this one to this one, you see there's not much change. Then if we look at the other two means that we used, so an estimated mean based on the empty model, but even the true mean, it doesn't really reduce the bias very much. So I was really shocked when I saw this, and I checked it many times, and other people checked my code, and even Tiomir looked at the code, and we're very sure that this is true. And then later, Tiomir found out that this is actually very well known in econometrics literature known as Nichols bias. So in the paper, we sort of suggested, well, maybe it's better not to center the lagged predictor, although you want to center the lagged predictor to get an intercept that is interpretable as the person's mean. So then you would have to run two models and present results from different models, even though you're interested in only one model. So it was not a good thing to be reporting in a way. So that's what happens when you use standard multi-level regression software. If we try to do this kind of analysis, we are faced with the following problems and limitations. Well, first of all, as I just said, you have this negative bias in the autoregressive parameter. So that's referred to as Nichols bias. Also, you can only have one outcome variable. So if you have a multivariate model you want to run, you have to have separate models for this. And there are some ways to trick the program into having more than one outcome variable, but it's very complicated. So the people that are doing dynamic networks are typically doing separate regression models for each outcome variable. Also, you can only have observed variables as your outcome, but also as the predictors. Whereas you might want to have a factor model to account for, you know, a latent variable, or you want to account for measurement error in your model, or you want to have moving average terms, which is also a component in time series analysis that's being used a lot in other disciplines. Missing data are a problem, because if I have a missing score on my outcome, the lagged predictor will have a missing score at the next occasion. So if I have a lot of missings, then I will have very few cases where both the outcome and the predictor are observed. So that could really be a problem. And we have a lot of missing data, of course, if we ask people all the time. They get bored with filling things out, or they're busy, or, yeah. And another problem is unequally spaced data. The ESM data are by definition unequally spaced in time because you want to catch people in the moment. You're not going to ask them at 9 o'clock and 10 o'clock and 12 o'clock, but you ask them at random time points. such that they cannot anticipate the next measurement moment. So they just are going about their normal lives. So we have these unequally spaced observations, and one way to deal with this is by adding missing data in between to make the cases more equally spaced, even though not all observations or cases are then observed. But that wouldn't work if you try to use this approach, because if you lag the predictor, then yeah, you get this problem. If there's too much missingness, there's nothing left. The good news is that dynamic structural equation modeling in M+ tackles all these problems and more. So that's something to be really excited about. It's certainly something that I'm super excited about.